Numbers chapter 13, verses 1 says this. The Lord said to Moses, the Lord said to who? Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the Israelites. Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which, in other words, is the promised land, which I am giving to the Israelites. The Lord said to Moses, send some spies into the land that I am giving them. The land was already theirs. If I come to you and I say, hey, I want to give you a gift, it's no longer mine. It's yours now. Can't take it back. You know, there's some people like that. They give you something. They want to be takers. They want to take it back. But God is not like that. He said specifically to Moses, who led the people out of Egypt to explore the land of Canaan, which is the promised land, which I am giving to them. And so we see that he sends one from each tribe, a leader from each tribe of Israel. There was 12 tribes. And so the Lord said to Moses, send them to the land which I am giving them. Say, I am giving them. So it's already yours. I need some of you to understand something, that there's a land that God has given you that's already yours. You just haven't possessed it yet. You just have yet to take possession of the land that God has already given you. I'm going to prophesy to some of you today. Some of you better grab this. And then we as we read, and here's verse 16, because the next verses are not on there, but verse 16 says this. As he names all the tribes, all the men of the tribe, as he names all of them, here's verse 16. It's really interesting. It says, these are the names of the men Moses sent to explore the land. That was the previous verses. And it says, Moses gave Hoshea, son of Nun, the name Joshua. Moses gave Hoshea, son of Nun, the name of Joshua. It's interesting because all of the names that he read there was one that he said, I got to change his name. It's interesting because at the time, Moses had to change Joshua's name because there was something about this guy named Joshua that was going to be a predecessor. He was going to be the one that was going to take over the land that Moses was not going to enter. Are you with me so far? So there was something about this guy named Joshua. And so there was something in his name. There's a meaning in his name. You know me. If you come here, you know that I love to look at the Hebrew meanings of the words and the Greek meanings of the words. And so it's interesting because we can imagine when Moses first met Joshua and he asked, who are you? And he says, I'm Hoshea. In other words, Hoshea means I'm salvation in Hebrew. Hoshea means I'm salvation. And you need to understand something. If you're about to possess something that God has given you, you can't be the one that thinks you got there on your own. I'm salvation. If you're going to lead God's people, you can't be the one that says that you are salvation. In other words, I'm the one that saved you. And so Moses does something, and he replied, and he smiles at Hoshea, and he says, sorry, now your name is Yahoshea. Hebrew, Yahoshea, which means Yahweh is salvation. Joshua means God is salvation. Did you know that? That's what that name means. So he says, I'm going to teach you, Joshua, who our salvation comes from. They may have named you this, but I'm going to correct that. Because in the land that you're about to step into, it can't be that you are the Savior. There is only one that can save my people. So, I need to correct your identity. Because they've called you Hoshea your whole life, which means that you're salvation. But what you're about to step into, you can't be the one that's going to save anybody. Let me help some of you in here, because some of you are control freaks. And you think you can control the situation. And you think you're the one, okay, I'm talking to somebody now. and you're the one that can control everything, let me tell you, you're really out of control. So God needs to change your name. God needs to change your identity. Because if you think you could control him, and I can control my kids, and I can control my spouse, and I'm the one that, and God says, wait a minute, I'll let you run in circles all day. Because I'm salvation. The Bible goes on to say, verses 17 through 25. We're going to read 25 in a second. But this is a precursor to what's going to happen. I need you to understand the next verses that we're going to read. If Joshua's name would have been I'm Salvation, he would have never entered the land that God promised, because he would have thought it was him. Today I'm going to talk about success. And some of us have, we look at success differently, but for God, success is way different than what man looks at. See, for success for some of you may be the house in PV on a mansion, the mansion in PV on a hill, money galore, but that's not success in God's eyes. Some of us think that having everything is success, but success for God is different. And so I'm going to share this with you today because Joshua entered a land that was flowing with milk and honey, but if he would have entered it believing that he got himself there, he would have never given God glory. And this is why Moses needed to change his name, to remind him of who he really was. That I am nothing and God is everything. Are you with me? It's important. So as I get into this, verses 17 to 25, the Lord sends them into the land to test them. Because the first point he made in verse 1 was, the Lord has given them this land. I've given the Israelites this land. He told Moses, I've given it to them already. It's already theirs. But send spies into the land anyways. Now watch this. They go in, and here's verse 25, and this is where it starts getting good. You ever watch a movie, it's like, it's boring. Let me fast forward this bad boy. This is what's going on here. I'm fast forwarding this for you. Verse 25 says, when they returned from spying out the land, there was 12 spies sent, right? One for each tribe of Israel. In that was Caleb and Joshua. I want you to remember their names, because the other ones, you'll never remember their names. When they returned from spying out the land, at the end of 40 days, 40 is a significant number, they came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the sons of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh, and brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the land's fruit. So they brought back these big grape clusters. I can imagine, you know, you ever had them Sam's Club grapes? They're like that big. I don't know what steroid they're putting in them grapes, but them. And then they're seedless. How do you get the seeds out? That's been my question forever. Like, how do they suck though? I don't know. But anyways, I'm thinking every time my wife gets, and I like the hard grapes. I don't like them soft and gooey. I got teeth. I'm not a kid. I want to eat them. I want to break my teeth on a grape, you know? I don't like them sour. I like them tasting good, but I like the hard ones. So if you ever get me grapes, get the hard. Make sure, hit them like that. Make sure they're good. But so I'm thinking, I'm an imaginer. I love to imagine things. And so as they brought back grapes, I'm saying, wow, they must have been massive and really hard and juicy. So they bring the fruit. Watch this. Next verse. They responded to Moses and said, we went into the land where you sent us, and it certainly does flow with milk and honey. Literally, it wasn't milk, but milk was it was used in terms of abundance. And so the land was very abundant. And honey was a delicacy, I'm sorry. It was a delicacy. And so you don't think of honey like bees' honey, because that was a very, very expensive thing they had. It was very expensive. It was a delicacy. So what they're saying is it's flowing with all this stuff. It's an abundant land. It's great. Here's its fruit. Now here's verse 28, because here's how some of us speak sometimes. What is the first word that you see there in verse 28? Say it with me again. But. Another verse says, nevertheless. Another verse says, despite. In other words, what they're saying is there's an issue. But. So here's their report. Here's their report of the land. But the people who live in the land are strong and the cities are fortified. They're walled. And they're very, what? Large. Moreover, we saw there the descendants of Anak, people of great stature and courage. The descendants of Anak were giants. They theologians believe that they were each of them were like 9 feet and taller. So they were the warriors of the time. The descendants of Anak were there. Let's go forward. The people descended from Amalek live in the land of the Negev, south country. The Hittite, the Jebusite, and the Amorite live in the hill country. And the Canaanites live by the Dead Sea and along the side of the Jordan. Let's skip that next verse because I want to go to verse 31 because they keep complaining. Verse, I can't see with that. Okay. I guess that's verse 31. I don't know. Let me turn around. It says, but the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people of Canaan, for they are what? Too strong for who? Can I remind you what God told Moses to tell the men in verse 2 of that same chapter? Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the Israelites. For they are too strong for us. So they gave the Israelites a bad report about the land, which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we went in, spying it out, is a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people that we saw in it are men of great stature. Is that where it ends, or we got one more? There we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak, are part of the Nephilim, another giants, and we were like grasshoppers in what? Our own sight, and so we were in their sight, and there it ends. Let me give you four issues with the 10 spies report. There was 10 of them. 12 of them went into the land. 10 had their report, and 2 other had their report, okay? So 12 total. Here's the report of the 10 spies. Number one, let's go to number one. The men are strong. The men are too strong for us. Let me go back to verse 2. Send some men to explore the land of Canaan, which I'm giving to the Israelites the land I am giving to Israel. The first issue, even though there was a promise from God, the first issue was the men are strong. They forgot who was on their side. Don't forget who's on your side. You can't forget who called you out of Egypt. Who called you out of the desert? You are where you're at, and you need to thank God where you're at. Don't get ahead of yourself. Just thank God for where you're at now because he's called you out. Let me say it like this. The word says, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. So why would I be afraid of their strength? If greater is he that's in me, issue with their report. Here's the second thing. The city is fortified. It's walled. In other words, there's no way to get in. Well, how'd you guys get in? And here's the second issue on that. And very what? Large. Here's my thought process behind that. People don't see things the way they truly are. They see things the way they are. People don't see things the way they truly are. They see things the way they are. I'm small, large. I'm small, large. You see? They were small-minded and small thinking. If you're small-minded, you're going to stay small. If you're thinking it's small, you're going to stay small. I'm poor. I'm never going to be anything. Guess what? You're going to be poor and never have anything. Pastor's preaching on prosperity. No, I'm just preaching on your mind. Why does the Bible... Why does the Bible teach so much about your thinking? Because this is the battleground. Ephesians chapter 6, it talks about that we're not fighting against flesh and blood, right? There's something that you need to put on your head. It's called the helmet of salvation. Why? How many of you have been in the military here? Anybody in the military? I know Nell. Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you for all. Thank you all for your service. My cousin was in the Gulf War, where they went to, what was the guy that they knocked down the statue, was his name? Saddam Hussein. No, was that Saddam? Yes. So my cousin was in the Marines. He was a sergeant in the Marines, still is. It's been several years. And he was one of the ones that went into Saddam Hussein's castle. He actually showed me pictures of his toilet. He had a gold toilet, solid gold toilet. They were in there breaking things to put them in their pockets. I ain't going to say that, but they were. How you have a solid gold toilet? I wouldn't want to ever use that toilet. I'd just stare at it the whole time. How can I put that around my neck? No, I'm joking. Anyways, obviously, Marines are the first ones. They're front line. They're getting the brunt of everything. And so he got shot at several times. He was sharing with me that there was one of his partners, got shot in the head. What saved his life was his helmet. They make those specifically. Now, it can't stop everything, but it's specifically hardened for that. Its purpose is so that you don't get killed. I need you to get this spiritually, because if you don't have a helmet of salvation on, the devil's going to make you believe you don't belong. He's going to make you believe that you are not saved, that you don't belong to Christ, and that everything in your past has made you think that you cannot excel. So we need to put the helmet of salvation on. So why? Because the devil's constantly throwing darts at you. You're not good enough. You're not going to make it. Your family's never going to make it. This is the report. These guys didn't have no helmet on. Watch this. The city is it's very large. It's fortified. It's too big for us. Let me tell you something. You may see CWC like this, but ain't going to stay like this. I'm prophesying to some of you to believe that you keep coming late, you ain't going to make it in here. You're not going to make it in the parking lot, because we are going to be very large. Not for my glory, for his glory. We're here to change a city. We're here to change a state. We're here to change a nation. We're here to change a world, and we can't stay small. So it should bug you like it bugs me when I see empty chairs, because that's somebody's life that's at stake. It bugs me when I walk in, I see an empty parking lot, because I know what we carry and I know whose we are. And when I know whose we are, I should be upset that people aren't hearing about this Jesus that transformed my life, about this Jesus that transformed my marriage, about this Jesus that healed my body. But this is their response. But here's the next one. There's no vacancy. The Hittites, the Jebusites, the whateverites, they're all here. Amalekites, they're in our land. They're in the land. They didn't even call it theirs. Let me tell you something. God had already said, it's yours. I didn't ask you to live with them. Hey, some of you, stop living with your parents already. If you can afford it, stop living with mom and dad. The Amalekites, the Hittites, the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Canaanites live there. There's no room for us. In other words, we don't fit. And God was saying, I didn't ask you to fit. I'm removing everyone. But you're looking at who's there. I'm not asking you to look at who's there, because who's there is not going to be there. You are going to be there. I need you to open up your understanding to know, even though they're in that land, that's my land. And let me tell you something. Every time I drive by that casino, I'm like, oh, yeah, you're filling up the parking lot right now, but that's my land. That's where we're going to have a church. Every time I drive by, I'm like, okay, put them tents out. I'm just going to use those tents when we have an outdoor event. So keep them outside. Keep them there. I heard they're remodeling in the inside. I said, good, you're going to save us money because you're remodeling it for us. Even though it's fortified, can I tell you, last year I called them. When the pandemic, my wife is my witness, I called them. I called the man. I found the number. I called Larry. He passed away, but I called him. I called his assistant. I said, hey, listen, I need the parking lot. We need to do an event out there. They never called me back either. But I'm going to tell you what. They knew who I was. I called like 5 or 6 times. I'm like, you're trespassing. You're trespassing. There's no vacancy. Listen, I'm here to tell you that what God has promised you, it may look like people are there and it's already full. But guess what? You're about to step in and God's about to remove everybody. Oh, I need to share something. We have a young lady here that just got accepted to UCLA, right? Even though this is a USC church, I'm just saying. I love the Trojans, boy. Don't mess with my Trojans. But we will accept you, America. But let me say something. Not anybody can just get accepted to UCLA. You know why? Because there's too many applicants. But when God opens a door, when God opens a door, even though they say you can't, there's no room, but God says, I'm going to make room for you. I need you to understand this. Because some of you have been complaining to God and say, God, well, I guess there's no room for me. God's saying, if you're going to say a but, then I'm going to let you stay on the outside. But if you believe in me, I can make room where there's no room. I can make a way where there's no way. Come on. The men are strong. The city's fortified. It's very large. There's no vacancy. And here's the last thing they said. Let me say this. God is removing everyone for you. He's gonna part it like the Red Sea. I feel this in my spirit. He's about to part some things like the Red Sea for you. When the Israelites said, how are we going to get across? Moses, what did you do? When they're chasing them, and all of a sudden, Moses gets his staff, and he goes, boom, and the Red Sea parts. That's one of my dreams. I want to go there, and I want to see it for myself. Just to go, I mean, you could go on YouTube, but I want to stand there and be like, wow, how did you part this, God? And the Bible says they walked on dry ground. I don't know about you, but when you go to the water and they part, it's all mud. And they walked on dry ground. Because what's impossible for man is not impossible for God. Watch this. I gotta get through this. 4 minutes? Okay. Here's the last thing. We're like grasshoppers. They said this in the last verse. We're like grasshoppers. Go back to that last verse. Can you go back to that last verse, 33? It's something they said that really impacted me. It says, they saw the Nephilim, and we were like grasshoppers in what? Our own sight. This is why you got to watch what you tell yourself. Because if you say, I'm small, you're going to stay small. I'm no good. I'm never going to make it. Guess what? We are like grasshoppers in our own sight. Wait a minute. What was the difference between David and Goliath? About 9.5 feet. But the difference between David's mindset and Goliath was, Goliath saw a little boy and David said, I'm a giant because of my God. You got to understand who you are in God. And this is why he couldn't even put on Saul's armor. It was so heavy. He said, just take this off me because what was made for you is not made for me. I need to go in who I'm called to be. And he got a stone and knocked this old giant down. And he got his own sword and cut his head off. He couldn't even pick up that sword. I share that because the last thing they said is we're like grasshoppers. There's giants there. They're too big for us. Guess what? You will never conquer a giant if you speak like that. And you'll always stay where you're at. Never enough for what God created you to be. Our vision is simple. Belong, believe, and become. Become what all God created you to be. My life's mission is to help people discover their purpose in this life. Because after this life, it's too late. That's my life's mission as a person, as a human being. My life's mission is to help people discover their purpose in life. I was in Australia at a conference, and I'm with my cousin, Pastor Obed, and we're talking, and he had this key, and it had his a word on it. And I said, "What is that?" He said, "That's my life's mission, my life's purpose." He said, "What's yours?" I said, "Man, I don't have one. I want to bring people to Jesus." And he says, "Yeah, but you need to identify what it is God is calling you to do." And I realized people would always ask me, "Pastor, what's my purpose?" And I'd be like, "I don't know. Ask God." And I realized that my purpose was to help people discover their purpose. See, some of you have been out of alignment so long. You've been doing something that God never intended you to do. That you've been like this. You've been thinking like a grasshopper. I'm too small. I can't do it. Why? Because you're out of alignment. And my job is to help you get right back in alignment so that you could do what God called you to do. Watch this. So this was their report. So they were defeated in their mind, and so they never had a chance to defeat their enemy. They never had a chance to defeat their enemy in the natural because they were defeated in their mind. All the while forgetting that it was God who brought them out from Egypt and that there was nothing impossible for him. But here's Caleb's report. I'm not going to leave you with something bad. I'm going to leave you with something good because I got to go. Here, let's go to Caleb's report. Here's what Caleb said in verse 29 and 30. It says this. Then Caleb silenced the people before Moses and said, "We should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it." Verse 30, then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, "Let us go up at once and take possession of it, for we will certainly conquer it." You see the difference. Here's the difference. Caleb saw things differently. So here's Caleb's report. Why did Caleb see things differently? Because he was reminded in verse 2 that God said, "This is the land I'm sending spies in there, but this is the land that I've already given you." He saw things differently. They were in the same. They all went together. They spied the land together. But because Caleb had a different perspective, he saw things differently. Your perspective matters. Because when you walk into a situation, you can say, "There's no way." Or you can walk into a situation and say, "All things are possible for God." Let me help some of you. You walk into your home and you see your parents are on drugs, or your kids are on drugs. You're saying, "There's no way." Or you can walk in and say, "You are a son of God. You are a daughter of God. There is more for you." You see the difference? It's perspective. I can walk into my job and say, I'm not happy here. Or I can walk into my job and say, "God, you have me here for a purpose. Who do I need to speak to about you? Who's hurting right now? Who's broken right?" Perspective matters. I got to finish this. So here's the first thing Caleb did. The Bible says that he quieted the people. Why? Because they just heard a bad report. And let me tell you something. Anytime you hear something bad, it's just negative, 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 negative mindset, negative Nancy, right? Sometimes it's good to shut people up. Because all they hear is themselves, and what comes out is nothing but negative thinking. Sometimes you say, "Okay, just be quiet for a second. Hear the word of the Lord. Not everything is bad. Because God allows bad things to come to us because he wants to get the glory in the end. Some of you better get this. Because some of you walked in here saying, "God, why is this happening?" God answered you right now because he changed my preaching because I wasn't supposed to preach this. So you can understand that God has a purpose behind your pain. Woo! Write that down. Okay. He quieted the people. Sometimes it's okay just to, "Hey, listen. You're talking too much. What's coming out is just nothing but negativity. I don't need to hear negative." Some of you, you live in toxic environments. And all you're hearing is toxicity. Sometimes it's good to get out. Clear your mind. Because if you're in toxicity, eventually that's going to enter you. And then you're going to be talking like that. And somebody's going to be like, "What's wrong with you? Why are you always angry?" I don't realize. Why? Because you're in the midst of toxicity. Even though Caleb and Joshua were in the midst of toxicity, they didn't let it enter them. So he quieted them. Hey, sometimes you got to quiet your thoughts. Get your thoughts quiet and listen for a second. So here's the second thing he did. He said, let's go up at once and take possession. In other words, no more waiting. Let's go now. This ain't for everybody, but this is for somebody. Stop waiting. Caleb had a now spirit. I'm going to call it a now spirit. He wasn't waiting anymore. Like, it's time to go now. It's time. I've been waiting long enough. It's time to go now. God already gave it to us. What are we waiting for? God's on our side. If God is for us, who could be against? Come on, let's go. Right? No more waiting. Let's go now. Here's the third thing he said. We'll conquer it. How can he say that? There was no question. There was no question because it was an assurance of who his God was. God said, it's ours. We're going to conquer it. Now watch this. Here's the way Caleb and Joshua saw it. This is why they saw it this way. I'm going to share some three things with you. This is what they said. This is just my thing, but this is what they said. They said, grapes are reachable. Giants are defeatable. And guess what? I am no grasshopper. They said this. Grapes are reachable. We can get them. The giants are defeatable. And I am no grasshopper. I'm a son of the Most High God. I'm a daughter of the Most High God. I'm not small. My God didn't create me to be mediocre. He didn't create me to be normal. He created me for greatness. Why? Listen, I love Jesus. Jesus was a king. Who goes backwards? Sitting on a throne, comes down to this earth to be born in a manger, a stable. To show his humility as a king. Yet as a king, he transforms a world. A carpenter. Can I say this? It's because Jesus knew who he was. You know, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 3. At the end of Matthew chapter 3, Jesus is being baptized. The Bible says when he's coming up out of the water, there's a voice from heaven. And the Bible says this, that God says, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. This is my son in whom I'm well pleased. Can I say this? The next chapter right next is Jesus is led into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. Matthew chapter 4. But Matthew chapter 3, Jesus had not healed anyone. He had not performed a miracle. He had not fed anyone. But God said this, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. So what you do doesn't please God. It's whose you are that pleases God. Who you belong to. It's apparent that I love my kid no matter what. If they do something for me or they don't, I'm still going to love them. Sometimes I want to smack them hard, but I love them. Can I say this? That it was Caleb and Joshua's mindset that God said, I love you. No, I'm going to prove it to you. Watch this. What made Caleb and Joshua different? This is not, I don't think they have it up there, but watch this. The Bible says, because they had a different thinking. I need to help you understand this before I end. Here it is. Exodus chapter 33, verse 11. It's important. Because the Bible says that Moses was in the tent. Joshua could not enter. Joshua was a young man at this time. And Moses is praying in the tabernacle, in the tent of meeting, they called it. And so Exodus 33:11, you can look at it on your own time, but I would save that scripture. The Bible says that when Moses left the tent, Joshua stayed there. In other words, Joshua was a lingerer. I love that word. He made it a point to stay in God's presence. Now I'm going to help you if you want to be successful in this life. It's important to understand, in order to achieve lasting success, it'll depend on who you're spending time with. Because you can achieve success in man's eyes and make it to the top in man's eyes. But God says, I never created you for that. There's some people that are chasing the American dream. Houses, money, cars, all those things that are not lasting. Because when you die, you ain't taking nothing with you. It's going to stay right here. You're going to give it to your kids and they're going to mess it up and spend it all. This is why I'm spending everything I got. I'm joking. Let's go. Somebody loves that. Let's go. I'm going on vacation as much as I can. If they get $10, they get $10. They better have went to school and worked. Say this, Joshua had a different spirit. Caleb had a different spirit. Watch this. Joshua was a lingerer. If you are going to make it, you're going to have to be a lingerer. Joshua conquered the land because he was a lingerer and he had a genuine relationship with God. God knew him and he knew God. You're not going to conquer if you're going to do it in your own strength. You're going to get burned out. As a matter of fact, you're going to get burned out. You're going to leave church. You're going to leave God. And you're going to try to go because people are telling you. And you're listening to man instead of listening to God. And you're going to be a success in their eyes. But God, you don't know God and God don't know you. And when trouble comes, the first person you're going to call in is God. Because we all do. And God's going to say, I don't know you. Joshua was a lingerer. Here's a second one. Numbers chapter 14, verse 24. The Bible says this. Numbers 14, 24. Watch this. I got to get this to you. I know I'm way over. It's the worship team's fault. They went over. Joking. But because my servant Caleb has a different spirit and follows me wholeheartedly, I will bring him into the land he went to. And his descendants will inherit it. Right before that, God is saying why the other 10 spies will never enter the land. But, he says, Caleb, what did he have? He had a different spirit in him. Let me say it like this. He wasn't moved. He wasn't swayed by the crowd. This is why nowadays you got to be really careful. Don't be swayed by the crowd that's protesting and breaking into people's thing. Don't be swayed. You better stay in the word. Don't be swayed by who's in the White House. Don't be swayed. There's a purpose and a reason God is doing all what he's doing. And he's trying to get his people to be united. You see what the devil is doing in the world. He's causing division like crazy. And he wants this race against this race. And this, that's what he wants. But God is saying, I want a church that can bring everybody together to show what true love is, true unity, true. This is what God is doing in these days. And so Caleb, he had a different spirit in him. He wasn't swayed by the crowd. Watch this. Joshua 14. The Bible says, I got to read this. Joshua, son of Nun, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, who were among those who had explored the land, tore their clothes and said to the entire Israelite assembly, the land we passed through and explored is exceedingly good. If the Lord is pleased with us, he will lead us into the land, a land flowing with milk and honey, and will give it to us. This is Joshua and Caleb speaking. Only do not rebel against the Lord and do not be afraid of the people of the land because we will devour them. Different mindset. Their protection is gone, but the Lord is with us. Don't be afraid of them. You see a different mindset. If I keep reading, it says they were going to grab Caleb and Joshua and stone them to death. That's what it says. Watch this. I got to read it. But the whole assembly talked about stoning them. Then the glory of the Lord appeared at the tent of meeting to all the Israelites. In other words, the glory of the Lord stepped in and said, you think you're going to stone them? I'm backing them. I need you to get this. Because God was backing Caleb and Joshua, not the other 10. And what I'm telling you is God is backing you up. You got, God got your back. He got your back. He got your back. He got your back. And so, Caleb and Joshua were protected. But here's my last scripture. Are you with me? I hope you're getting something out of this. Joshua chapter 14. Joshua chapter 14. The Bible says this in verse 6. This is what happened after they entered the land. Can I tell you? The only two that entered the promised land from all those people was Caleb and Joshua. Over the 1.2-3 million Israelites, the only two that entered were Caleb and Joshua. The other 10 spies, their descendants, they didn't enter the land. It was the kids that entered the land that had a different mindset. So here's what 45 years later, Caleb was 40 years old when all this happened. And here in Joshua, fast forward, Joshua chapter 14, it says this in verse 6. It says, now the people of Judah approached Joshua, Gilgal, and Caleb, son of Jephunneh, the Kenizzite, said to him, you know what the Lord said to Moses, the man of God at Kadesh Barnea, about you and me. He was reminding Joshua, who was now the leader. Remember what Moses said about us? Here's what he said. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to explore the land, and I brought him back a report according to my convictions. Watch this. My mindset. What I believed and what God was saying. But my fellow Israelites who went up with me made the hearts of the people melt in fear. I, however, followed the Lord my God wholeheartedly. So on that day, Moses swore to me, the land on which your feet have walked will be your inheritance and that of your children forever, because you have followed the Lord my God wholeheartedly. Watch this, I'm almost done. Now then, just as the Lord promised, he has kept me alive for 45 years since the time he said this to Moses while Israel moved about in the wilderness. So here I am today, 85 years old. He's from 40 to 85, so 45 years he's been in the promised land. But there was still a piece of land that God promised him, that Moses had promised him through God. Now watch this. This is good. Then Joshua, verse 11. I am still as strong today as the day Moses sent me out. I am still as strong today as the day Moses sent me out. How can he be as strong at 85 from 40 years old? You know why? Because it's a mindset. Because he wasn't talking about not only physically, he was talking about I'm still as strong spiritually. I know who I believe in. I know who my God is, because even though the other ones didn't step in, I stepped in this land. Now watch this, what he says. Because I'm just as strong, I'm just as vigorous to go out to battle now as I was. This brother was a fighter. He wanted a fight. Watch this. Now give me this hill country that the Lord promised me that day. Can I say this? 45 years later, I don't know how many years later, God has promised you a land and you're about to step into it. Some of you have been waiting. You're saying, God, when? When is it? God is saying you're about to step into it. It may be years later, but you're about to step into it. I feel this strong. Some of you are not getting this, but some of you have captured it. This is for you. This is for you. I feel the Holy Ghost right now. Watch this. Watch this. Watch this. And then it says, you... give me this country that the Lord promised you that day. You yourself heard then that the Anakites, in other words, the giants, verse 12, is it up there? Oh, you're awesome. So I need my glasses. Then that the Anakites were there and their cities were large and what? Fortified. What was one of the complaints of the spies? Their walls were large, they were fortified, right? That was one of, but he says, I heard that the Anakites are there and their cities are large and fortified, but the Lord helping me, I will drive them out, just as he said. Now watch this. Let me say it like this. Once a giant slayer, always a giant slayer. Okay, some of you got that. Once a giant slayer, always a giant slayer. They said this. They said, we can't go in because the Anakin were there. Not Anakin Skywalker. No, the kid, whatever. You know the word? The Akin or whatever. I don't know what they are. Anakin Skywalker's there. Somebody's there. The giants are there. The Nephilim are there. We can't go because we're like grasshoppers in our own sight. And Caleb said, I know whose I am. I know who I belong to. I know who gave me that land. So you may be a grasshopper, but I'm not a grasshopper. And guess what? Because you didn't want to fight the giants, I want the giants. I don't care that it's 45 years later. I'm about to slay some giants. I'm about to slay some giants. Come on, some of you better get this. God is wanting you to slay some giants. Oh, he wanted the fight. He wanted the fight. He knew they needed to be faced and defeated. Come on. You want that land, you're going to have to face some giants. Oh, my shit. You want that land, you're going to have to face some giants. But guess what? If God is for me, who can be against me? Why could he speak so boldly? Because he knew who was with him. Just know this. Who is by your side? Who's by your side? Who's by your side? Who's by your side? You're not alone. You've been thinking you've been fighting this thing alone. God said, no. I've been right there. And you're going to have to face some giants, but you're not facing those giants alone. The difference between David and his brothers is his brothers looked at their physical self, and they looked at their things, their sword and their armor. And David says, I don't have that, but what I do have and who I do know is going to help me get through this giant. I just hear him talking about my God. I hear him defying the God of Israel, not on my watch. I'm about to take this giant out. And some of you have to have that mindset that you can no longer stand idly by while other people are possessing the land that God called you to have. You need to step into your purpose.
Hey, thank you for watching. But why don't you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss a single video? By the way, why don't you share with your friends as well so they can enjoy these messages with you? Once again, thank you for watching, and every Sunday we're here. Join us live.